Let's look at the facts of our Lord's birth. And the first fact is, he was not born in December. He was born somewhere around the end of September or the beginning of October. For the seventh month of the Jewish calendar bridges our September and October. And it was during that time that the Feast of Tabernacles was held. And it's quite clear from our Bibles that Jesus was born in the Feast of Tabernacles. How do we arrive at that? With a very simple bit of mathematics. 9 plus 6, which is 15. And with that simple sum, you now know when Jesus was born. We're told that his cousin John was born to Zechariah and Elizabeth. When Zechariah went into the temple and was told that his wife, who was way past childbearing, would have a son and should be called John. That was how John the Baptist began. Now, when the angel Gabriel came to Mary and told her that she would have a son, even though she'd never known a man, he also said, "And the proof will be that your cousin Elizabeth is also amazingly pregnant at her age." And immediately Mary set off to visit her cousin, who lived in a little village near Jerusalem. And when she went into the room, her cousin Elizabeth felt the baby inside her jump. The first time she'd felt that. And she said, "My baby jumped for joy when you came into the room." And they shared what had happened. Now, it says that that was when Elizabeth was 6 months old, or 6 months gone. And 9 months later, Jesus was born. 6 plus 9 is 15. If we knew when Zechariah went into the temple and was told he was going to have a son, and add 15 months to it, we'd know when Jesus was born. Do you follow me? Well, from the Book of Chronicles, the second Book of Chronicles, we know in chapter 24 there is a list of the priests who had a rota to go and serve in the temple. And Zechariah's turn to serve is listed there. He was the eighth out of 24. And therefore, a third of the way through the year, Zechariah went into the temple. When you add the 15 to that, you come to the seventh month of the following year, which is the Feast of Tabernacles. And every Jew believes the Messiah will come at the Feast of Tabernacles. It's written in their scriptures, it's written in their culture. And so that's when they expected him. You find in the book of John that the Word of God became flesh and tabernacled among us. You also find out that Jesus' own brothers, who were skeptical of who he was, when the Feast of Tabernacles came round, later in John's Gospel, the brothers of Jesus said, "It's the Feast of Tabernacles, you better go and show yourself in Jerusalem if you're the Messiah." And they were teasing him. They knew that the Feast of Tabernacles is when he should come. I'm also convinced that's when he will come again. I can't tell you the year, but I can tell you the month. It'll be in the seventh month. And that's when Jews all over Israel celebrate the future coming of the Messiah. And they have that in that month precisely for that reason. So he was born end of September, beginning of October. The biggest miracle in Jesus' birth was not the birth itself, though that's where the world focuses when they celebrate Christmas. The real miracle happened 9 months earlier. It was his conception that was supernatural, because Mary had never had a sexual relationship with a man. Now, that's not the only virgin birth there has been. A professor of gynecology in London University once told me that there have been probably half a dozen, 6 or 7, virgin births in the human race, recorded, claimed. But he said the one thing that convinced him that claims were possibly established was that in every single case, the result was a baby girl. And it would have to be a baby girl. The scientific process is called parthenogenesis, when a female egg spontaneously divides and produces an individual without having been fertilized. It's common in the vegetable world. It's not unknown in the animal world. The Komodo dragon is one species that has virgin births. And as I've said, there are records of it happening to humans, but never to produce a boy. So here undoubtedly is an amazing miracle. And there are 3 possibilities. We now know enough about conception and birth to know what could have happened. And there are 3 possible things that God could have done in Mary's womb. First, he could have created a complete initial fetus and planted that in Mary's womb. If that's what happened, then God was the father, but Mary would not have been the mother. She would not have contributed to the fetus. She would be a surrogate mother, nothing more than an incubator. So it can't be that. The second thing that could have happened, the only difference between a male and a female fetus is in one tiny chromosome. And in every cell in my body, every chromosome looks like a letter Y. In my wife's body, that chromosome looks like the letter X. All that God needed to do was just a tiny bit of genetic modification, to use the term that's popular today. Now, if that were the case, Mary would have been the mother, but God would hardly have been the father. The third possibility, the one I incline to, though I wouldn't be dogmatic on this, is that God created a male sperm bearing the DNA of divinity and fertilized one of Mary's eggs with his created sperm. That would mean that Mary was fully the mother and God was fully the father, and the resulting child would be human and divine together. So it's that third possibility that appeals to me. However, the miracle is that Mary produced a baby boy without the help of a man. That has never been heard of before or since. Let's go a little further. I've told you that I think Joseph must have been a fine young man to believe in a dream and act upon it. And in a second dream, he was warned about Herod and took Mary and the baby as refugees to Egypt, where no doubt they had to sell the gold, frankincense, and myrrh just to keep alive. And then later, when Herod died, they came back to Nazareth. So he only had 2 dreams. We don't have a single word that he ever said, but he acted on those 2 dreams. And to believe them and act on them must have taken tremendous faith. I'm looking forward to meeting Joseph. Now Mary, Protestants say far too little about Mary. Again, the Roman Catholics have said far too much. And we have reacted against that. And we say far too little. I've heard so many sermons about other characters like Peter and Paul and John. Rarely heard a sermon about Mary, but she was the first charismatic. She was the first one to say, whatever the Holy Spirit wants to do with me, I'm willing. And she spoke in tongues on the day of Pentecost. I've never heard all that mentioned, have you? But it's there in your Bible. Mary was a most wonderful woman. And I enjoy preaching on Mary. And I've done so in front of a bunch of 60 Roman Catholic priests, with a cardinal sitting in the middle of the front row. And my subject was what the Bible really says about Mary. I said, it doesn't say anything about her immaculate conception or her perpetual virginity. She had more children, at least 7 of them after Jesus. Or about her bodily assumption to heaven. And I went through the dogmas, the 4 dogmas that the Roman Catholics believe, and I said that none of them are in the Bible. But I said, you have discouraged us from preaching what is in the Bible about Mary, because you have added so many things that aren't in the Bible. One of which I'll come back to, a very important one. Now, as a human being, Jesus had a beginning. But when you write the story of Jesus, where do you begin? Mark said, I'll begin with his baptism, because that's when his public ministry began. Matthew said, no, you've got to go further back. You've got to begin with his birth, and you've got to trace his family history back to Abraham. Luke came along third and said, no, you've got to go further back than Abraham. You must go back to Adam, because Adam was the ancestor of Jesus. Finally, along came John and said, you're all wrong. Go back to the very beginning. And he took the words from Genesis 1, in the beginning, he already was. That word was is very significant. Not in the beginning he began, but in the beginning he was. Already there. And since the human mind can't go back beyond the beginning of all things, you just can't imagine when there was nothing, not even space. We can't imagine that. So you can't go further back. And what John is saying is, at the very beginning, he already was there. And he was face to face with God. And he was God. Of course, the Jehovah's Witnesses have had to change that in their Bibles. They don't accept Jesus' full divinity. But this means that Jesus' birth was unique, not in the way he was born, but in the fact that he chose to be born. Nobody else in the whole of history has ever chosen to be born as a baby. He voluntarily chose to be born. You didn't, I didn't. You didn't choose your parents, I didn't choose mine. We had no choice. But Jesus had, and he chose his parents and chose to be their baby. That's the most amazing thing, and yet I never hear it mentioned. In any nativity play, did you? I never saw it on a Christmas card. Love to see a Christmas card saying, the man who chose to be born. Now there's a truth for adults, not children, but for adults. Make you think. Well, now the problem that John had was, if he existed before his birth, even before his conception, what was he called? He only got the name Jesus after his birth. And he only got the title Christ when he became the Jewish Messiah. That's what it means. And he only got the name Lord after his resurrection and ascension. So what was our Lord Jesus Christ called? And John, with his inspiration of the Spirit, called him the Logos. That's the Greek for word, but it's much more than word. John was writing his gospel in Ephesus, where there was a man called Heraclitus. And Heraclitus was the father of modern science. And he taught his students to use their eyes to observe what went on and to find out the reason why things happened as they did. And the word for reason why is logos. And every branch of science has the word logos in it. Psychology, physiology, zoology, meteorology, everyone is a study of how things behave in that field until you know the reason why it does it. So meteorology studies the weather and asks why the clouds come and drop rain, or why the wind goes this way, or why, the reason why. And that's the basis of all science. And John called Jesus the Logos, because he's the reason why everything else behaves as it does. He's the reason why. Isn't that a lovely title? And so in the beginning was the Word, the Logos, the ology of all our research and all our questions. He's the reason why. He's the answer. And then he wrote these amazing words. The Word, the Logos, became flesh and tabernacled among us, pitched his tent among us, lived among us. That word flesh is very important. I want to add five adjectives to it to bring across the sheer wonder of it. The Word, the Logos, the reason why, the second person of the Godhead who'd always existed along with his Father, but chose to become a baby, took upon himself physical flesh. You could touch it. He could touch people. They could touch him. It was real physical flesh, such as you and I have. Secondly, it was male flesh, not female. I know Jesus has been claimed to be both male and female, and the most famous picture of him knocking at the door. Do you know that picture by Holman Hunt? Holman Hunt used three females as models for that picture. One for the long ginger hair, one for the face, and one for the figure. It's a thoroughly female Jesus in that picture, so I'm not too fond of it. Jesus was male. He came to show us God, and God is a father, not a mother. He's king of the universe, not the queen. He's husband of Israel, not the wife. And therefore, to show us God the Father, it had to be male flesh, whether we like it or not. Thirdly, it was Jewish flesh. He was born and circumcised as a Jew and is still Jewish. Yet most Sunday school pictures of him are of a Scandinavian with fair hair and blue eyes. That's not Jesus. He was Jewish. with a Jewish nose. And he's still Jewish and always will be. And the next thing is, it was sexual flesh. There's been a kind of common impression that Jesus was sexless. If that's so, then he didn't have the problems that I have and that every male has. And he didn't overcome them, as he calls us to. It was sexual flesh. And in his teen years particularly, he must have had sexual temptations. There was a film recently that caused an outcry called The Last Temptation of Christ by a man called Scorsese. And it imagined that Jesus had sexual temptations. Well, that's true. He must have done. It was male sexual flesh. But he didn't give way to any of the temptations that brought. He overcame them. And finally, and this may be a shock to you, your New Testament says his flesh was sinful flesh. Now we rebel against that. We think, no, he was without sin. Yes, he didn't sin. But he was made in the likeness of sinful flesh, which means he took on our fallen human nature and had that battle to face as we have to face. If it wasn't sinful flesh, then he hasn't fought our battles and can't give us the strength to. But he's been tempted in all points, like as we are. And the three points we're tempted are the world of flesh and the devil. And Jesus was tempted in all points, just as we are. Now that's a truth that many Christians can't accept. The Catholics have invented the Immaculate Conception of Mary to get round the problem. And they believe that Mary was born without sex or without sexual temptations. And therefore she was able to produce a boy who didn't have sinful flesh. But if Jesus was born of Mary, then our fallen nature was passed to him through Mary. And he had the battles we have, but he never gave in. And he won the battle. It's Paul who says he was born in the likeness of sinful flesh, Romans 8. And people say, just a moment. He says he was born in the likeness of sinful flesh. You mean just the appearance? No. The word likeness means exact reproduction. It's used in Philippians 2, where it says he took on himself the likeness of human flesh. And that really means he was reproduced as human flesh. And Paul says the same thing as sinful flesh. Now, my time has gone again. So I'm going to finish these three talks with this very direct question. Do you think it is appropriate to mix this pure Son of God with all that goes on at Christmas, with the office party, with the mistletoe, with all the rest of it, with the huge expense, with all the money that is spent, even on the children? Do you think it fitting to put Christ in the middle of that? The one thing that is certain is nobody is going to be able to abolish the sentiments of Christmas that come from its pagan origin. There have been so many attempts to clean up Christmas through the centuries that when you read the history of it, you realize it never succeeded. These things should not have been brought into the church. They should have been left outside. And people coming to Christ should be told, you leave these things behind. You don't bring them in with you. So we're left with that basic question. Do we want to mix Christ up with all that? And I'm afraid my answer is no, we don't. Let's rescue Christ from Christmas. Let's celebrate his birth when it really happened. It's much cheaper and simpler to do so. Let's separate Christ from all that is not of him. And let's worship him as he ought to be worshipped. That's my final word on Christmas. Thank you for listening.